and UNI basketball. Tonight, the Panthers of the University of Northern Iowa host the University of Iowa Hawkeyes. Now, here are tonight's starting lineups. At one forward for the Hawkeyes, a 6'3 sophomore from Gardena, California, number 24, James Moses. At a forward for your Panthers, 6'4 and a sophomore from Maywood, Illinois, number 32, Cedric McCullough. At the other forward for Iowa, a 6'7 senior from Bellwood, Illinois, number 45, Michael Ingram. At the other forward for your Panthers, a 6'8 senior from Nashua, number 50, Steve Fife. Starting at center for the Hawkeyes, a 7-foot senior from Bobells, North Dakota, number 51, Les Jepson. Starting at center for your Panthers, a 6'8 senior from Des Moines, 00, Jason Reese. At one guard for Iowa, a 5'10 sophomore from Palmer, Iowa, number 11, Troy Skinner. And a guard for your Panthers, a 6'2 sophomore from Venice, Illinois, number 11, Dale Turner. At the other guard for the Hawkeyes, a 6'5 sophomore from Summit, Illinois, number 32, Ray Thompson. And at the other guard for your Panthers, a 6'5 junior from Davenport, number 44, Troy Nuremberg. Head coach of the Iowa Hawkeyes in his fourth year, Dr. Tom Davis. Of your UNI Panthers in his fourth year, Eldon Miller.
A year ago in Iowa City, it was the Hawkeyes on top, 95-76. They have dominated this series, but this year, Mac and Bob, the story is totally different. They feel that they can win this ball game tonight.
And rightfully they should. The opportunity that the UNI Panthers have had, Summer League, Primetime League, they played against the Hawkeyes. Iowa no longer has Marvel, Armstrong, Horton. They are a bona fide veteran group. Four starters back. They are not going to be intimidated by Iowa. Iowa's best for its reputation.
But the big crowd, that could be a big factor. Iowa has played with big crowds in the NCAA playoffs. This UNI team has never played like any kind of a game like this. It could be a factor.
The Hawkeyes coming off a win over Monmouth, a win that they struggled with, shooting very poorly, and UNI coming off a road trip to Las Vegas, playing Georgetown last time out, playing them close the first half, but then getting blown out in the second half.
I think, Bob, if you look at the X's and O's, one of the things you're going to look at is Iowa's offensive rebounding. The offensive rebounding by Iowa historically has been a tradition mark. UNI has to stop them. On the other hand, the Panthers have to score off the break.
Jason Reese, though, he proved that he can play with Alonzo Mourning, which means he can play with anybody in the Big Ten. He'll be certainly a big factor as well.
Steve Fife will jump center against Les Jepson. Joey Sylvester will toss it up. The Hawkeyes and the Panthers from the dome. And it's Iowa controlling the tip. That's Troy Skinner with the basketball. He'll run the point for the Hawkeyes.
They're in a man-to-man, Bob.
Reese on Jepson right now. Ingram back up on top to Thompson. Now Skinner. Skinner shot well for the first time this year. The last time out had 10 points against Monmouth. Tom Davis is hoping he'll break loose and give him some more offense from that point guard position. Jepson with the basketball. A shot clock down to 15. Iowa having trouble finding a shot. 10 seconds on the shot clock.
They had trouble scoring against Monmouth. It might be the same factor again tonight.
Skinner finds Jepson all alone inside for two.
Good pick set inside. Jepson found himself wide open, Matt.
You'll probably see right now Iowa just go with man-to-man pressure early, but the best defense all year for the Hawkeyes have been zone pressure, falling back into zone quarter-court defense.
Jason Reese drives inside, kicks it back out to Turner. And now Muhlenberg on top. He's a three-point shooter along with Turner. Turner leads the team, shooting 48%. And the big guy can hit outside as well.
Well, he played well against Alonzo Mourning, and that was really a tough loss, obviously, for UNI. They shot very poorly, but he proved that he could play with anybody.
And it gave the Panthers some confidence that they could play with a top 20 team like Iowa. 9-2 early first half. 23,000 folks here to see this extravaganza in the dome.
Quite a night, isn't it?
Wonderful. Ingram goes inside, travels, turns it over.
And Bob Ingram has been one of those spiritual leaders for the Hawkeyes. Really gets after the ball, diving on the floor. He's going to have to look out for some of those hustle dives with this raised floor tonight.
One of the keys for the Panthers, breaking that pressure of Iowa. They will try to score off the break. And Muhlenberg hits the three. He is deadly when he is open.
Muhlenberg can shoot from about 20 if he wants to. Goodness sakes, that was a pretty shot.
Eldon Miller said they will attack the pressure and try to score off of it. That time they did. Moses from three. Hard off the rim. Again, follows his shot. And Cedric McCullough pulls it down for the Panthers. 5-2. And Reese shakes loose underneath.
The crowd really into it. You can tell this is a pro-UNI crowd if you couldn't tell from introductions.
Skinner drives, throws up a prayer, and it'll be the Panthers' ball underneath. UNI is taking it to Iowa early.
Turner, an excellent job bringing the ball down court. Good selection by him, giving the pass to the inside.
And already, Tom Davis will go to his bench Garner, for some help. Ryan Garner, Wade Lookingbill, both check into the lineup.
Garner gives you a tremendous amount of speed, and of course, Skinner hasn't been shooting well until he made a couple of threes in the last game. There's long, that pressure.
Long outlet pass to Muhlenberg. Reese loses the basketball inside. Iowa back the other way on the break. And Garner throws it away. Three-on-one break. Reese at the front of it. Back to five.
No call, no call. They want a timeout.
And the Hawkeyes find themselves down by 7 early. The Panthers on top, 9-2. You're watching UNI Basketball on the Iowa Television Network.
And here's the fast break. Look at this. Jason Reese, the big guy, going up against Garner, finally gets the pass off, knocks over a man. No harm, no foul, and Fife gets the easy two. Look at the field goal percentage, Mac.
Well, you look at that. UNI, good scoring opportunities, mostly over Iowa's pressure.
Coming into this ballgame, it was the Panthers that were concerned about turnovers. They felt like they needed to hold the turnovers down to 10 or 11, and it's Iowa turning the ball over early. A.C. Earl is now in the basketball game for the Hawkeyes. Tom Davis looking for an answer.
He gives him shot-blocking ability, and of course, the fans love him in Iowa City. We'll see what he can do offensively. Look at this by Thompson.
Big lead move by Ray Thompson, taking it onto himself to get on the board.
He's only a sophomore. Steal.
Iowa's pressure creates a turnover, and Lookingbill just loses the basketball right through his legs and out of bounds.
Iowa's had trouble lately having that ball come to people, and they just take their eye off of it on that bounce pass, losing it out of bounds. It's happened a couple times to Michael Ingram against Monmouth.
Three Iowa turnovers, two by UNI. Jason Reese takes it up strong, has it slapped away. The Panthers will still control it underneath. Reese is going to the basket, though, no doubt about it. He is challenging the big guys inside.
Well, when Reese gets it, you can usually look for an offensive shot. He has only gotten 6 assists the whole season.
NBA teams are looking at him. They love his wide body at 6'8", 240 pounds.
couple of scouts here tonight, as a matter of fact. Willis Reed requested press credentials for tonight's ballgame. Jonathan Cox with the basketball, just checking in for the Panthers. He is not going to provide them any offense, but Mullenberg will. Two in a row from three-point range.
Reminds me of Randy Kreienbrink, the way he throws up that three-point shot. He's pretty to watch.
Eight-point Panther lead, and another steal. McCullough, one man to beat.
Holy cow, look at this. Northern Iowa looking tremendous, up by 10.
It's not been a surprise. Iowa's gotten slow out of the blocks the last three games. They've gotten down double figures and had to fight their way back. They won two of them.
Garner was in trouble for a moment, came up smelling like a rose, got the easy layup inside. It's an eight-point game, 14-6.
That's good to see, because sometimes he gets a little bit out of control. Found himself and got himself under control that time.
Cox almost lost the basketball. McCullough across, and the Panthers look to score quickly. Mullenberg picks up the charge after the pass to McCullough down low.
Well, Moses just really held his position. Lots of times you get a no call in that situation, especially when you're working with Big Ten refs, because bodies go flying all the time. We've got a mixed crew now.
15:47 left to play. The Panthers bolting out to an early lead in this one. The crowd here loves it. A pro UNI crowd.
Well, they're rooting for the underdog.
Thompson can change things in a hurry, though. The Hawkeyes' leading score.
When the offense breaks down, Ray Thompson is a guy that can go right to the basket.
Reese goes diving out of bounds. We talked about not being much room on those sidelines. The players looking possibly a little tentative as they start to go to the basketball.
I don't think there's any question about that. When you're not used to playing on a raised court, you give second thoughts about giving up your body to the floor.
It's really scary because you go flying into the first row of the stands. Goodness sakes. A lot of these guys went around when Williams Arena, you know, up at the University of Minnesota campus. So none of these guys used to play like there.
AC Earl inbounds to Ingram, almost loose, and finds Earl inside. He goes up with his shot. That puts it down, and all of a sudden, it's just a four-point lead for UNI. Panthers need to protect the basketball. They've had trouble getting it across the last couple of times.
Good to see Earl getting the points, though.
Brad Hill now in the ballgame for the Panthers.
Panthers 6-for-7 early, but the Hawkeyes have scored on their last four offensive attempts.
Uhlenberg went flying. You see him?
Baseline, it's Hill. Mullenberg fighting for the ball. It's Thompson coming up with it ahead to Moses on the break. He pulls up and pops. It's just a two-point game.
Eight straight points for the Hawkeyes. They can go on a run. They've done it for the last 3 years under Davis.
Talk about a momentum shift in just 5 minutes.
Almost another steal.
Cox looks for Mullenberg. He's got two threes, puts up one from inside the three-point line. Mullenberg with eight of the Panthers' 16 points.
And he's an excellent scorer. He's got the great outside shot. People come out on him. He just gives a one dribble fake into the inside, gets himself open again.
Skinner in the corner, back out on top to Moses. He'll shoot it from there. Although Iowa, a very poor three-point shooting ball club.
Notice that where they were laying off of Skinner?
Traveling.
I don't think the Panthers really respect Troy Skinner's outside shot at this point. They want him to get that ball in the air from out there. They want him to prove that he can hit that ball.
There's not a lot to respect at this point. The guy's only shooting about 25% for the season.
Yet he was the second all-time scorer in Iowa high school history. Still trying to make that adjustment to big-time college basketball.
It's a tremendous change, certainly.
Mullenberg brings it across. 16-12 our score, exactly 14 minutes to play. And the block by Jepson.
That's what he does best.
Thompson pulls up from three.
At least the Panthers are boarding well. That's one factor that Iowa hasn't taken control of yet.
Two-on-one break. Moses and Thompson. Moses pulls up baseline.
Eldon's going to need a timeout here.
And UNI loses the basketball again. The pressure paying off.
The bench is calling. They want a timeout after the next made basket.
Jepson from downtown. Mullenberg almost loses the ball. The Panthers having a hard time getting that ball across the 10-second line after attacking and breaking the pressure early.
And the Panthers really going with three guards now. We've got Cox, Turner, and Mullenberg in there. And, of course, Brad Hill, a very good ball handling player. So UNI trying to counter Iowa's pressure with some good ball handlers.
The key is not losing the emotion that you felt early in the ball game when UNI was so sky high. You can't lose that.
Cam Johnson will come into the ball game for the Panthers, a 6'2 freshman from Jefferson High School in Cedar Rapids. Wade looking to go back in also. And Rodell Davis has checked in for the Hawkeyes. He has not been used that much this year, Matt.
No, he hasn't. And I think you're going to see the Hawkeyes really look at Cam Johnson and give him a little extra pressure when he handles that ball. As you said, just a freshman.
That's Johnson with the basketball in the right corner. The Panthers have been very pleased with his play early in this year. He did not predict in the preseason as one that would see a lot of time, but he's showing that he can play. Wellenberg from three. This time he misses it, but it's Johnson fighting for the ball and comes up with it from Jepson to Mullenberg. He'll try again. This time he gets it to go.
Jepson overemphasized the rebound attempt. That's what hurt him.
Great defensive play by Fife. He was up in the air and yet slapped the ball away on the way down. No foul call. Four-point UNI lead, 18-14, 12 and a half left to play. That's Davis on Johnson. Back out on top to Turner. He started as a true freshman last year along with Cedric McCullough. Turner will take the baseline jumper and knock it down. Another three for UNI.
Turner looking more and more this year to the basket, hitting over 50% of those three-point shots. Set himself the square of the basket.
Look at Bill sending an illegal pick away from the ball, much like an offensive tackle would, and he got called for it.
Wade looking at Bill, one of the Iowa products on the Hawkeyes team out of Fort Dodge. Mr. Basketball in Iowa.
Excuse me, Bob. He's one of those Iowans that was recruited by UNI.
Along with Troy Skinner. Yep.
Finally get that timeout.
11:56 left, 23,000 fans at the Dome. And the Panthers on top by 7, 21-14. Back with more on ITN.
Well, you've got Looking Bill trying to power up, being able to go up by good reaction, being able to get the ball. Slap it away. Good block by Fife that time.
Brought Tom Davis up off the floor, not the bench, quickly, though. He wanted a foul call there. It's interesting to see how the officials are going to call this game. I know when you and I went down to Iowa State, they called it very closely. Jason Reese had foul problems. That doesn't appear to be the case tonight.
No, it does not at all.
There's the freshman, Johnson, not willing to take the shot. McCullough puts it down. Cedric McCullough.
Great athlete. Shows he's a good scorer as well. Look, the lead's up to 9. Look at the lob.
Jepson almost loses it. Davis shakes loose inside. Fife battling inside. 3 black shirts inside. Finally, the Hawkeyes come out with the rebound.
That's their forte, offensive boards. Haven't seen much of it tonight until that sequence.
That's really what they do best. When you miss a shot, they have 4 people on the glass. You and I have to block out. Have to take care of those detail things.
2 out of the last 3 years, the Hawkeyes leading the nation in rebound. They have credit to Rudy Washington, their coach in that area.
Rudy does a great job. He's led the Big Ten all 3 years.
James Moses at the line. He's hitting 78% from the stripe.
Ray Thompson back into the lineup too, Bob, and he's just an incredible offensive player for Iowa.
Moses hits the second. It's 23-15. Bob Healy along with Mac McCausland and Bob Hogue with us tonight for the play-by-play.
Cam had a pull-up jumper again, didn't take
it. Second time, passed it up.
Better not to make the mistake, though. Don't force it.
Back to Johnson, now sagging off inside on 5. You hear the officials in the background saying, watch the pushing inside, starting to get a little more physical.
Kind of nice that Eldon Miller has a chance to rest Reese at this point.
Deep in the corner, it's McCullough. That may be a little out of his way. 8-point UNI lead. Brian Garner takes it to the hoop, finds Jepson. The UNI bench wanted to travel or walk. No call.
Great dribble penetration by Garner, catching the trailer, Jepson.
Panthers meeting the challenge. They still lead in the ball game. They maintain their composure above everything else.
And doing it, as you said, Bob, with double zero. Jason Reese getting a breather right now. Inside to Fife. He shakes free for the shot. Hits fouled from behind by A.C. Earl.
What an overachiever he is. A guy that went to Oral Roberts, and I was talking to Kevin Boyle before the game, the assistant coach for UNI. He says, we're so lucky to have this kid. Look what he's done. He hasn't had the big numbers this year, but he gets the ball away and somehow gets the shot off. Mackey's just sweet.
He's really become a very good, competent athlete. When he first came into UNI, he really lacked some of the confidence, playing in front of crowds and so forth. Gained the self-confidence, and now is a complete player.
Great high jumper, you know, 6'10" that he can high jump.
State champ in high school, as a matter of fact.
Had his troubles when he was there at Nashua, goodness sakes, just a great athlete.
He's had his troubles at the free throw line, just 55%. Nails that one. Fife with 5 points. It's a 26-17 UNI lead. Surprised at all at this point, the Panthers jumping out like that?
Really, I'm not, Bob. I think that the Panthers are well-drilled coming into the game on how to beat Iowa's press. They've done a good job with it. The thing is to be able to sustain it and retain the ability to be able to keep coming at Iowa, not get satisfied with the lead. Some teams do.
Thompson scoring on the other end. He can change a game so quickly.
Notice now with Muhlenberg back in the game, Thompson respecting that shot, coming further out. They open the inside a little bit more with Reese back in and Jonathan Cox running the point guard position.
Iowa will not really come out on Jonathan Cox.
He is not what you would call a shooter.
He's a ball reversal point guard.
Muhlenberg from way downtown.
Heartbreak shot because that one looked like it was all the way in the basket before it came out.
Ingram has it slapped away by McCullough, diving for the ball out of bounds. The Hawkeyes will retain possession. It is not just one player doing it for the Panthers. Steve Fife with the jumper off the glass does not go, but look at the Panthers go to the boards. McCullough with the rebound inside. 28-21, the Panthers by seven. UNI out rebounding Iowa.
What a surprise there with Iowa, such a great rebounding club. Give a credit to Eldon Miller. So far has drawn up quite a perfect game plan.
Reese finds an opening inside the paint. Jepson brings the ball down to the floor, still loose. And Muhlenberg has an opener inside there, still can't get it to go. Jepson's in trouble. They'll call a foul on Jason Reese.
And look at Davis. Is he hot on the sidelines or what? He wanted to call a little bit earlier. He is just furious.
Dr. Tom throwing a few elbows of his own.
Little Mount Davis erupting over there. And
Eldon
Miller.
Little stern look from Coach Miller.
Hey, they're going to work the officials. They want the calls to go their way. Skinner was wide open, didn't take the shot.
James Moses, you don't have to tell him to take the shot, but he traveled before he got it off.
Moses loves to put it up, has since his high school days in Carson, California.
Now we're going to see some what Eldon Miller hopes is instant offense. Maurice Newby will check into the ball game. He's been sort of a question mark this year for the Panthers. Redshirted a year ago, but he can fill it up in a hurry if he gets hot.
Well, and he needs to for the Panthers. Muhlenberg has been the offensive threat on the outside perimeter. Newby was expected to compliment him, just has not done it yet this year.
Back to Fife. Panthers trying to work it across, and they do to Newby.
Of course, Newby and Reese, the first two recruits that Eldon Miller signed.
And quite a coup there because he was at Ohio State for so long. The fact that he was able to come back and get a Division I player like Reese is really incredible. We traveled.
Reese turns it over. 10 Iowa turnovers, 9 by UNI. 10 turnovers, about where Iowa or UNI would like to be for the ball game.
And Reese has missed his last 5 shots.
Almost stolen away. I think he's a lot quicker than Jepson.
Well, that's been the rap on him, though, by the pro scouts, so that ability to get up and down the floor may hurt him somewhat. He may end up being a very good European player.
Yeah. You got to look, he's going to have to play the four spot in the NBA. Jason Reese, we're talking about, where Les Jepsen will be able to play the post position.
What a turnaround it has been for Les Jepsen from a couple of years ago when he was just a non-factor. Of course, he's a very good friend with D.J. Armstrong, who has probably the best work ethic I've ever seen. Les has adopted it.
Yes, he has. He's done very well with it. Put himself in position to make himself some money.
Moses driving inside. The Hawkeyes keep it alive, just tipping at the ball still. Alive, and Moses comes up with the cripple, and it won't go. Panthers got a break.
Well, again, James Moses gets the shots, but shot selection not good, out of balance.
Reese had time to talk to the official after he got the rebound. How often do you see that? Hey, maybe. He turned around and said, hey, say, call it the same way both ends.
Mo puts it up, won't go. Steve Fife coming over the back for the rebound, but it's James Moses that will pick up the foul.
They've been stuck on this seven for a long time. Both teams not shooting well for the last couple of minutes.
Some fresh blood into the Iowa lineup. Ingram, also Garner, check in. Here's Jason getting his 2 cents worth.
Watch him turn. He says, hey, they're reaching. Now, come on, ref. It was almost as if there was a timeout.
A.C. Earl.
Oh, my. A.C. Earl. The freshman does it. And here's a steal.
Ray Thompson sliding out of bounds just as he was about to save the basketball. The Panthers will hold on to it, but A.C. Earl, plenty of power on that one.
Well, the fans love him down there, and whether he'll grow into his body, I don't know. He kind of looks like a colt growing to become a stallion, doesn't he?
I tell you, he's got great timing, Bob. He's got an uncanny knack to just flip at the last second and block a shot away.
28-23, we're down to 5.5 left in the first half. So far, all the hype, all the buildup, I have to say, this game has lived up to it. Fine, got undercut as he went up. No call again, they are letting him play.
Probably should have been a foul call there.
Garner goes all the way under baseline, shakes free for a shot, the ball's still loose underneath, and now tapped out of bounds, he'll give it to Iowa.
All the black shirts just pounding away. They literally are pushing for the outside. They get the Panthers too close underneath. That's why they get so many of the offensive boards.
That time all five Hawkeyes were up on the glass.
Ray Thompson inside, the rebound by Ingram. And Iowa is winning the battle of the boards now. McCullough takes it to the hoop. Knocked away by Earl.
How about a goaltending call? Will they get a goaltending?
See if the official gives it to him.
Great block by A.C. Earl. Just holding off a three-on-one break.
As we just talked, Earl able to go up and slide it away. They gave him goaltending.
It looked like a goaltending. I think it was. It looked like he was dropping the ball into the basket. Tom Davis can't believe it, but you're going to get goaltending called 9 times out of 10 on that shot.
Jason Reese will come back in. Also, Les Jepsen, not a very popular call. You see the Iowa crowd booing on the sidelines. Jason Reese back in. Eldon Miller, he's up by 5, 30-25. McCullough can add to it.
Well, certainly one reason it's not popular is it was probably 10 seconds after the foul was called before they gave the basket.
I hate late calls. I do. I hate when they mail them in.
Garner on the point, got an opening. He'll take it again to the hoop for the uncontested layup.
They're concerned about the pick, Bob. They want to stop that man from rolling to the basket at 7-1.
Dale Turner comes down, beats the pressure, pulls up from 15. Back to 5-point lead.
Well, they get a 3-on-1 break every time.
Mullenberg comes up with a steal. Matt Turner's pushing it up. Baseline to McCullough, jam time!
Oh my! What a jam on the baseline by Cedric McCullough! Baby, did he get up there?
McCullough's in double figures with 10. He brought the crowd to its feet. Thompson the other way. The foul will go inside, he'll go to the line. Power move by McCullough.
One thing you may want to look at a bit is the coaching from the bench. The head coaches, are up, and there's not enough communication between bench coaches and players. There's 7 or 8 feet back.
Here's a look at that slam dunk. UNI on the break, and here they go, just extending the body and going up over the big man. I mean, that's a big time jam.
Ray Thompson so far not very active in the first half. Just 6 points, make it 7 now. It's 34-28, just a 4-point game. Thompson throws them both. And with that, Rodell Davis will check back in. Thompson will go out and get a breather.
There's a timeout on the floor.
And we have got a timeout on the floor. 3:50 left to play in the first half. 34-29. The Panthers up by 5. This has been a game ebbing and flowing. The Panthers bolting out to an early lead back. The Hawkeyes coming back. And UNI has been able to hold on to that lead.
Well, as we go ahead and talk earlier about Iowa has gotten out slow. And they have done that historically this season. It's not unusual for them to come from behind. On the other hand, the Panthers have to be able to go ahead, keep that momentum, and understand how they got that 5- and 10-point lead. And there you look at some of the paraphernalia, the T-shirts, sweatshirts, as well as a banner. And you've got some Bob Uecker seats here. There's no doubt about that.
I don't think there's a bad seat here. You know, no, I was talking to some of the Iowa people beforehand who play regularly in the NCAA regionals. They told me that they think the UNI Dome would be a great regional site. It's just too bad that Waterloo Cedar Falls doesn't have enough hotel space, because they said that this site is actually better than most of the regional sites that they actually play in.
I've been to Seattle and down to New Orleans, as well as one of the other domes up at Pontiac and the Humphrey Dome. None of them can accommodate as many people as close to the court as this one does.
It's really a great place to watch a basketball game. There are a few seats that are blocked out just a little bit, but I don't think anybody's unhappy.
Of course, you've got the Mid-Continent Tournament this year here at UNI. Wouldn't it be great to get this kind of reaction to that and to do this for that tournament? It may be a few years away, but you're going to see some great basketball at the end of the year here. Jonathan Cox back the other way. He gets hammered from behind by Moses, who just got caught out of step.
Here's a look at that again. Watch Moses just go up over the back.
And that is now 7 team fouls to get the Hawkeyes. That'll put the Panthers in the bonus. Jonathan Cox at the line.
You know, Eldon Miller has always had a great reputation of having teams that can shoot free throws real well. You remember, Mac, how well his team shot at Ohio State several times. They took Hawkeyes right out of a game free throw shooting. And I say that, he misses the front end of the 1-1.
Only Cox's second chance of the year at the line. As a team, UNI shooting 72% from the line. And now Webb is in the game for the first time for the Hawks. What's Tom Davis looking out of him right now, Matt?
Well, I think right now he's trying to get some activity again out of Jay Webb. Try and get some points and offensive rebounds. Jay was very effective at UNLV coming in, giving the Hawkeyes a little spark.
Loses the basketball. It's Mullenberg. 2-on-1. Pulls up, pops it, drains it.
He got a high dribble, but he got into his rhythm again and was able to get the jumper off. As Iowa just didn't come back offensively or defensively.
Right now, this team is deficient in really having a good quarter-court scoring team.
And it'll go over to the Panthers. Brad Hill anticipated the pass, bolted out in front of Ingram, and the ball was thrown away. Les Jepson quickly back into the lineup. Iowa with 13 first half turnovers.
Three more substitutions come in. That gives Iowa almost 30 substitutions in this first half already with 2:48 to go.
A lot of fresh bodies.
A lot of them rotating in and out. And of course, that's Tom Davis' philosophy.
You saw Les Jepson making sure they had enough bodies on the floor as he was counting them there.
You get 10 yards with 6 on the floor. Johnson will pull up and take that jumper for the first time. Misses it. Hill inside to Reese. Won't go, but he's fouled.
Great pass inside. Tremendous pass by the JC transfer out of Michigan. And Reese having a little bit of trouble hitting the shot inside, but he is going to go to the free throw line.
Jason Race with just 4 points. Seems like he's been more active in the offense, but only 4 points here in the first half.
He hit his first two baskets, then he's missed his next five. Of course, that shot does not count since it did not go and he got fouled.
He's scoring most of the points on the transition game and pull-up jumpers. It's not been the inside work.
Jason Reese, one of the better free throw shooters on this team, 76.5%. He's their scoring leader, 22.7. But Turner, Fife, Muhlenberg, McCullough on any given night, as we have seen, can't put the ball in the hoop.
As you can see in the background, Tom Davis talking to Troy Skinner. Now Skinner will have to go down steps and out about 8 feet to the bench.
Back up to a 9-point lead, Bob.
2:30 left to play in the first half. Panthers would love to take a double-digit lead into the locker room. That's Garner on the point. Off the pick by Jepson. Back to the big guy.
Garner has a tendency to get himself in trouble a lot. Then he loves to drive and figure out who to dish through.
Garner drives inside, has it slapped away. And the ball is out of bounds. They'll give it to the Hawkeyes. The first time when I saw Brian Garner, I thought he was the quickest point guard I may have ever seen. The guy is so quick, but sometimes he goes beyond his ability. Big rebound that time by Muhlenberg.
I think Thompson couldn't believe how open he was after he made the move, turning to the inside.
Turner takes it all away. Call before the foul, though. Garner reaching in, trying to slap it away. And that'll put Turner at the line for the 1-1. See if you can pick up Garner slapping as he goes by.
Right there, reaching
in.
And then Ingram taking the charge. And that's a gutsy situation to do right there when you got the knee problems that he has had.
Five first half points for Dale Turner. 6'2", 193. Went to Venice High School in Illinois, just a sophomore. Started 27 of 28 games last year as a freshman. Now DeMiller says he could end up being one of the best guards he has ever coached, including his time at Ohio State.
Calvin Ramsey, it's hard to believe. Troy Taylor, all those guys.
This guy really has great court awareness. He has the ability to slide over to the two guard and could just be, like he said, the very best he's ever had. His assist to turnover ratio is always up at 2.5, 3-1.
11-point lead.
Jepson shakes loose inside for the easy two. Still, though, 40-31. Turner's in trouble, finally finds Hill. Panthers trying to break the pressure. Muhlenberg gets it across.
Garner reaching in.
Garner's picked up two quick ones.
Hawkeyes had a good double team and just over anxiousness. That time on Brian Garner's part, lifted a knee up, caught the side of Troy Muhlenberg.
Fife coming back into the ball game again. You know, guy, he got a chance to take a rest, and that was a luxury there. And Reese going back to the bench. Did you expect Jason Reese going to the bench twice in the first half, being in the position where you could put him down?
Only if he was in foul trouble.
Yeah.
Which is good news for Eldon that he is not.
Although the pace of the game almost dictates you have to take him out for a minute or 90 seconds at a time. Let him catch his breath, get his legs back.
I think Muhlenberg may be the story here of the first half. 13 points, and he just doesn't look like he's intimidated on the floor. That's what you worry about when you're playing a team that's bigger and stronger and got the reputation.
Hill inside, gets hammered, no call.
Jepson with the block.
1:24 to play. Garner driving. Looks like Cox may have picked up that foul, or Cam Johnson.
You know, but I really believe, Bob, that the summer league, the prime time league you have in Iowa City, about eight of the UNI players played there last summer. And, of course, it gave them a lot of confidence. They not only played against Iowa players, they played against Brad Lowhouse, Kevin Gamble, people in the NBA. All of a sudden, it elevates your self-esteem. And that's how they're playing here tonight.
Les Jepson, the MVP of that league, really made his mark there, averaging 35 points, about 20 rebounds a game.
You know, they're hoping that Jepson becomes a Brad Lohaus, a guy that really turns around in his 4 years at Iowa. And I'm not sure that he'll ever reach that stature, but he has improved markedly.
Isn't it amazing, though, that team with Horton and Armstrong and all the players that Tom Davis had the last couple of years, all five starters in the NBA. It's almost unheard of.
That team that almost made it to the Final Four when they lost to UNLV, I know they'd love to have that second half back. Sometimes you don't get to the Final Four, though, with your best athletes. Just ask Lute Olson.
Moses, half of the net on the second one. And fresh substitutions. Rodell Davis, Troy Skinner back in. Dale Turner also back in for the Panthers. 1:21 left here in the first half. An exciting first half of basketball. And a sold-out dome. It's been sold out for over a month. 23,000, the largest crowd ever to see an indoor game.
Skinner tipped it away. Look at Thompson. He's out of control. Les Jepson.
Put the exclamation mark on the end of that where Jepson shook free. Looked like he traveled before he went up for it.
Well, he looks like he travels a lot when he gets the basketball, to tell you the truth.
And that was all made possible by the pressure. Troy Skinner stripping it, and Raymond Thompson making the one-on-one move, getting defenders to come to him to free up Jepson.
Under a minute now, 44 seconds to play. Mullenberg in the corner. He's got Big Les in his space. Back to Cox. Inside, Fife shakes loose. Can't get it to go down.
Fock was wide open for that shot. I don't think he knew he was that wide open.
Clock. The shot clock is off now. Foul underneath. It'll go against Hill. And now both teams in the 1-1. 27 seconds left. 41-35. The Hawkeyes trimming away UNI's 10-point lead.
They were up by 11 at one point, so they're getting back into it. I mean, if you can pull it within five at halftime, you got to be very happy with the way the first half's gone.
Jay Webb checks in for Les Jepson, protecting Les Jepson a little bit, giving him a little more rest.
One thing that we haven't talked about is the fact that Iowa begins its Big Ten season this weekend against Ohio State. So they're preparing for that while UNI doesn't play a Mid-Continent game for a couple of weeks.
The company line you heard this week was, this is just another game. We're building up, but boy, it was hard for me to believe it, especially with this crowd here and the excitement.
You know, I really believe the coaches believed that, you know, between them, they've won almost 800 games. So they've played a lot bigger game as far as meaningful and conference standings, NCAA play. But it was hard not for the kids, especially from Iowa, the state of Iowa, not to get involved in this.
It just means so much to the UNI program. Boy, Tom Davis really going deep to his bench now.
Dale Reed from the Bags, Wyoming, the freshman, comes in for the last 25 seconds.
I'd like to see him shoot. He scored 40 points a game in high school.
Broke his brother's scoring record. All in the family. 15 seconds left. Just a four-point lead. Down to seven. Mullenberg will look for the shot, off balance, in and out. Fife slaps it out of bounds, the Hawkeyes will have it. Tom Davis says there should be a second left on the clock.
And there should be one or two, they have blown their whistle.
There won't be though, everybody's leaving. And Tom Davis is still coming out of the court. He is hot. He's
keeping
furious.
His players on the court now as the officials are walking off, but that is it. There will not be any time put back on the clock. So after 20 minutes, it is 41-37. The Panthers on top by four. We'll be back with halftime stats, and the lottery has a big giveaway for you. So stay tuned as you're watching UNI basketball on the Iowa Television Network.
The Iowa Lottery raises a lot of money for worthwhile projects, but we know that our games must be fun, too. We're making some changes for 1990. We'll be paying over 65% on our scratch games. No lottery in the country is paying more. For now, we're ending our second chance drawings. We'll devote $700,000 more in prizes to each scratch game. More dollars, more winners. It starts with Frosty the Dough Man. Remember, when you play, all Iowa wins.
Tonight's game is being sponsored by the Iowa Lottery. When you play the lottery, Iowa wins. And by Budweiser. Beechwood Age for that clean, crisp taste. This Bud's for you.
Hi, Lottery's Halftime Hoopla here at the jam-packed UNI Dome in Cedar Falls. Mike Pace is my name, and in the next couple of minutes, we're going to give away $105,000 to five lucky Iowa Lottery players, and we're going to be telling you about how Iowa Lottery profits are helping the University of Iowa and the University of Northern Iowa in research and development. Now, over here, of course, the drum is full of entries that have been selected on a weekly basis in preliminary drawings, and our broadcast is being monitored by the independent auditing firm of McGladrey and Pullen. So I say we get busy and give some money away. There's the auditors right there. What do you say? We have the help right now of Patty and Mike from the UNI Panther cheerleader squad. So let's get busy. And we need a $5,000 winner. Of course, if you had a scratch ticket that wasn't a winner, it might still be a winner. And here's Patty with our first winner of $5,000. Patty?
Jody Stenwall from Sioux City, Iowa.
Jody Stenwall of Sioux City, Iowa. $5,000. Congratulations. And here's Mike with a $10,000 winner. Did we have a half or what here at the UNI Dome? What a great game. Michael, $10,000 winner, please.
Robert Evans from Moline, Illinois.
Moline, Illinois. Robert Evans has won $10,000. Now we're ready for, well, they're friendly foreigners to the east. You know, now we have a $15,000 winner. And here's Patty.
Merwin Hart from Davenport, Iowa.
Merwin Hart from Davenport, Iowa. A $15,000 winner. Now, the next prize is for $25,000. And I have a feeling whoever wins this, it might even heal some wounds if their team doesn't win tonight. You know, Mike?
Yeah, I'd say so.
Who's our winner?
Don Thompson from Ames, Iowa.
From Ames, Iowa. Don Thompson has won $25,000. Now, our grand prize winner of $50,000 from the Iowa Lottery for sending in those non-winning scratch tickets. Here we go, Patty.
Joel Ose from Story City.
Joel Ose, I believe it's O-S-E, from Story City, Iowa. Our grand prize winner of $50,000 from the UNI Dome and the Iowa Lottery. Wow. Now, we'll be back here at the UNI Dome with lots more, but first, these messages.
This is Breakaway Action with Beth Delagardelle.
Here's a look at action coming up this week at the track following a record holiday week. Our 1 o'clock Wednesday matinee is business card day, and the third qualifying rounds get underway for the Pepsi-Cola Waterloo Cup. The top 8 point finishers advance to Saturday's championship. And the matinee on Thursday is College Educator and Quahog Club Day, and the disabled American veteran King Marsan, chapter number 11, will be our guest during Community Organization Night. Every Friday matinee is Senior Citizen Day, and Friday night is Hudson Community Challenge Night, with patrons from Hudson receiving a 4-for-1 special. And attend our weekly seminar every Saturday at 11:30 a.m. for answers to your wagering questions, followed by our 1 o'clock matinee. Saturday evening, racing starts at 7:30, and the Pepsi-Cola Waterloo Cup will be contested, featuring Waterloo's top 5-16 sprinters with an added $7,500 purse trophy and blanket. And the pick six is over $27,000.
They want me to take the mic and introduce the Bud Light Daredevil.
Cedar Falls, and I mean it is jam-packed with 23,000 fans of both the Panthers and the Hawkeyes, and it was a fabulous first half. And right now, some incredible entertainment from the Bud Light group here with all the fancy slam dunks and so on and so forth. But right now, I want to review our winners from the Iowa Lottery of $5,000, Jody Stenwall from Sioux City. We had a $10,000 winner from Moline, Illinois, Robert Evans. Mervin Hart of Davenport won $15,000. Don Thompson from Ames, Iowa, won $25,000. And our grand prize winner of $50,000 was Joel Osie from Story City, Iowa. And if you added up $105,000 from the Iowa Lottery tonight here at the UNI Dome, so send in those non-winning scratch tickets, whatever you do. Now, in addition to giving away lots of prizes, of course, the Iowa Lottery helps with research and development and job creation all over the state of Iowa. And right now, we're going to hear about how that money is helping the University of Iowa and the University of Northern Iowa. And we'll start with Dr. Rex Montgomery from the University of Iowa. Ado, Bob, my boy is a sophomore, 6'10", backup center, and hasn't seen any action tonight, but I know his... He'd give anything to be able to play, but he'd probably give more to see us win.
He's gotten his teeth cut on some top-notch competition, though. He saw some action against Georgetown. He has played some. He's a big kid, 6'10", who's still growing.
Well, he's a classic late bloomer, I guess. A rather immature kid physically, but he gained 20-some pounds this summer. He's getting a lot stronger, and we hope that he'll be able to step in there next year and do some good things.
It's great, this whole event, isn't it? What's your reaction to the hoopla we've had here so far?
I'll tell you what, this is absolutely fabulous for the state of Iowa. It really is. And I think you have to congratulate the University of Iowa and Coach Tom Davis for helping this to happen, because it does give the Panthers the opportunity to be on kind of an equal status in terms of home court advantage with the other teams in the state, and obviously we're up to it.
I guess everybody knows who you're pulling for right now.
That's right. I was Dr. Stanek said to try to be very neutral. I didn't do anything but purple socks tonight, so I'm doing my best.
Purple socks. All right. I don't know if we can get those on camera, but thanks. Thanks a lot.
Thank you,
man.
Bob.
All right. 41-37, our score at half. We'll be back with some halftime stats and more. You're watching UNI Basketball on the Iowa Television Network.
Not too many folks have left their seats for halftime. They are ready to see some basketball. What a first half. I was concerned, guys, that this game would not live up to all advanced billing. Boy, was I wrong. Great game so far.
It's like a Super Bowl that lived up to its advanced billing, and I think everybody's excited. I think that even the Iowa fans are excited that UNI is on top at this juncture.
It is what you expected, Mac. You know, you and I had the crowd behind them when we started the ball game, bolted out to that early lead. Iowa has come back, but yet Panthers have held on to a four-point lead.
I think you've really got to go look at the off-court leaders. And the off-court leaders, Tom Davis and Elda Miller. Elda Miller has his team well prepared. And at home, as you indicated, a lot of hype. More Iowa kids, home natives, on that UNI squad. They're really up for it.
Bob, when you were doing sports back here 5 years ago, could you imagine this happening at that point, that you and I would come that far?
Well, I didn't think they'd come this far this quickly. I was there when they beat Drake in Wisconsin and Kansas State, and they got crowds of 5,000, and that was neat. You and I came to prominence then. They're even bigger big time now.
All right, we'll take a look at some halftime stats in just a moment. You're watching UNI Basketball on ITN. Back with more.
Students at the University of Northern Iowa talk about the Northern Iowa advantage.
It's a really nice campus. It's not too big and it's not too small. You get to meet a lot of people.
Our pledge to provide quality undergraduate education.
Let's take a look at those first half stats. You and I rebounding very well early in the ballgame, Mac. It'll be interesting to see if they can keep it up in the second half.
Well, you've really looked. Everything's pretty equal. You just go right down the line. You look at field goal percentage. You look at free throws. Iowa's had a better percentage, but you and I had another opportunity. Rebounds about even. Iowa has started to take the lead. Iowa, though, surprisingly, they've got more turnovers, and they're not facing the pressure.
And there's the individual scoring, as Muhlenberg, I think, has really been the difference in this ballgame, although McCullen not being intimidated, scoring in double figures as well. Turner doing a tremendous job. Three-point scoring has been good. You saw that UNI was 3 of 7. Muhlenberg hitting a couple out there as well. So UNI just looking very strong and not intimidated in the first half.
Scoring for Iowa, Thompson with 10, Moses 7, Jepson 8. Nobody really in foul trouble for either team at this point.
And I don't think there's any surprises as you look at who the team leaders are as far as scoring opportunities. It may be the team that finds that fourth score, somebody that hasn't had the good first half, that ends up getting hot the second half, they become the team winner.
One thing that we have to bring up as we take a look at a replay from the first half is the fact that UNI trailed Georgetown by just 3 at halftime, pulled it within 1 in the first 3 minutes of the second half, and then just got blown away. Now here's Jepson with a slam dunk early. And he was pumped.
You know, you have to wonder, though, just as you said, about that intensity level, also about physically with the fast-paced ball game that we've been watching. Does UNI have enough bodies to run with Iowa? Tom Davis has run 10, 11 people into this ball game in the first half.
I don't think there's any question. The Panthers have tried to do that. They have got the depth this year. They can go 10 deep, and I think Eldon Miller has a lot of faith and confidence. And it can be shown by the fact he puts Cam Johnson, the true freshman, in there, who had not been expected to play a lot at the beginning of the year.
Do you make any adjustments at this point from what has worked, really, for both teams, only a four-point difference in the scoring? Do you make any adjustments if you're Iowa or you and I as you come out in the second half, or do you just take it as it happens?
I think the overall game plan is going to remain the same. I believe each of the coaches probably have looked and examined maybe one or two plays they felt were very good to them offensively, and they will keep those for special occasions when they feel they really need to get something going offensively.
It'll be interesting to see if Iowa works any of the backdoor lobs or something like that have worked well for Tom Davis clubs in the past. I think they've got the great athletes, the great leapers, and we'll see if we see some of those kind of plays.
Biggest crowd ever at UNI before tonight, 10,500 back in 1987. You take a look at the stands, they are filled to the rafters. 22-9 is what they're expecting. Probably squeeze in a few more along the way.
Yeah, I think there's a couple pair of binoculars up there somewhere, too.
And surprisingly, few poor seats.
Oh, yeah, it's great.
The people right behind us probably have the worst seats in the house. A lot of floor seats.
Who wants to look at the back of you?
Who? 41-37. You know, we're ready to start the second half.
We did start, Brian Leslie talked in the pregame about Ray Slater, Bob, and Ray Slater's grandmother passed away early this morning, and he'll be back in Washington, D.C. for a while. He will return to Iowa City. Whether he remains or goes back to the Iowa team for second semester isn't known at this time.
And Bob Bowlesby also wanted to pass along a few words, too.
He wanted to say hello to his mother, Pat. She's in the hospital, just had a hip replacement, and Bob Bowlesby has got to be extremely happy tonight. Looking at what Eldon Miller has done, and of course Terry Allen in his first year as a football coach this year.
Bob Bowlesby, the athletic director here at Northern Iowa. Jason Reese inside, fighting for the basketball with Jepson. Les goes down, but it is Reese who picks up the foul, number two on Jason.
Get the feeling that Eldon Miller said at halftime, Jason, we've got to get you involved in this offense. He took it right to Jepson. Jepson blocked it. Reese followed through and just really hammered him.
Reese with just 6 points in the first half.
Jason tried his bump and shoot where he turns, bumps into the defender, and then goes straight up.
There's that lob.
Thompson shakes free inside in the crowd and scores. Couple bodies go down. They are letting these guys play. Nobody may foul out of this game. And now we see the pressure in the backcourt. Moses with the tremendous steal.
Oh, my. Ray Thompson on the jam into the stands off that steal.
And Iowa did make a slight adjustment. They went back to find a player to guard on the defense. They are not playing the zone area more. They have gone to find a man to put pressure on.
And it's a tie ball game and almost another steal.
Moses all over the basketball. And here it is again. Ray Thompson after the tremendous save by Moses. It wasn't quite that fast, but he got it down.
Back to live action. Jason Reese taken into the hole, had the ball knocked away. But you know what they talked about at halftime now. Reese, you're taken into the hole for UNI. As far as I was concerned, get it to Ray Thompson.
Muhlenberg trying to get it in trouble, throws it right into the hands of James Moses. Three-on-one break. Thompson loses the basketball. Turner tries to save it, and he does to Reese. Fife on the break. Count it.
No question of whether Fife and Reese can get down the floor. They were flying down there. Great pass. And Fife showing great body control before he got fouled.
The only regret Steve Fife has is that he didn't jam this one on the other end because he loves to fly out on the break.
A tough situation. Iowa not able to convert at one end. And then they turn right around and give up the opportunity at the other. Continuation. Fife gets the bucket, but not the free throw.
They'll give the ball to Iowa.
And Joey Sylvester said,
now
I saw it.
We may have a change. Eldon's pointing the other way. The official underneath will give the ball back to UNI. Muhlenberg will take it. The official's conferring. Now they're going to jump it. And that means Iowa will get the basketball.
Well, that's a rookie Big Ten official, Mike Smith, underneath the basket. Joey Sylvester made the call from outside. Sylvester does Big Ten as well as Big East games.
Mullenberg on Skinner. Panthers by two, 43-41. Ingram down low inside. They go to Jetson. He's fouled. And that's Reese. He's picked up his third. Couple quick ones early.
Elder looking at the rest of his bench. Really take Reese out of there. Yeah, he's gonna. Lob in the inbound.
Jetson.
Rewalk.
Made a move in the bucket. He traveled. Now you're gonna see Eldon Miller substitute for Reese. He'll bring Brad Hill into the ballgame. Jason Reese going out with three fouls. Shades of the Iowa State game where he battled inside with Victor Alexander and was gone before it was over.
UNI answered a charge by Iowa early in the first half. Be interesting to see if they do so this time.
Turner finds Mullenberg. He's deadly from there. This one's short. Gets his own rebound. And they'll call a block. The block will go against Ingram.
There's one subtle change after halftime. Eldon Miller in the first half, coach from the front of the bench. Now he's on top of the floor. You see Mullenberg missed the shot. No block out. Mullenberg says, I'll go get it myself, which he does time and time again. Gets that rebound.
Turner will bring it back out on top. Still a two-point lead for the Panthers. They led by four at half. Hill with the turnaround jumper. Fife with the rebound, puts it back in.
Great jumper, Steve Fife. A tremendous position on that particular play.
Fife now with nine, and the lead is back to four. Thompson shakes loose. Great play by Hill to slap it away. Thompson wanted the call. Turner pushes it up. Finds an opening. Pulls up for three. Hill keeps it alive, and the Panthers are hitting the boards.
They sure are. They're matching him. Body for body.
Mullenberg, I'd look for him to take advantage of that matchup with Skinner at 5'10", trying to guard Mullenberg at 6'5".
Yeah, but you don't want to force a shot.
McCullough misses. And now Skinner pushes it across. Moses knocked away by Fife. And now Thompson will pick up the foul, trying to go for the steal. That is two on Ray Thompson.
I'll tell you, Tom Davis wants his players, when they go inside, to do some pump faking. Especially a shorter man, Moses, just 6'4", comes in to challenge a 6'9 player. You want to plant yourself, pump fake, get him up in the air, try and draw that foul.
Those are the exact two words that Davis yelled at him. Pump fake. He's a great teacher, Tom Davis is.
Fife has
blocked
it knocked away
AC.
By Earl.
Look at the smile on Earl's face after that block.
Thompson pulls Iowa within one, a three, 45-44.
Luckenbill reaching in, and Luckenbill just about got a tee right there. He hasn't liked one call against him this game. Intense competitor from Fort Dodge.
Panthers will take it out of bounds on the side. Just a one-point game, 45-44. McCullough looking for an opening. Takes it up at Earl. He may have got a piece of that one.
He did.
He definitely knew Earl was there. That's why he pumped.
Thompson, two in a row, same spot. Earl with the jam the other end. And Jepson now goes to the board.
Guy's on top now. Stepping up that pressure.
Took him 25 minutes to do it, but the Hawkeyes have taken the lead. McCullough. Back out to Turner. It's a three. In and out.
That really hurt. Heartbreak shot.
Garner inside to Earl. And Brad Hill will pick up the foul.
Brad Hill was thought to be that junior college transfer that could come in, be an athlete, and really give UNI some strong play off the bench. He has had one or two good games, but been inconsistent. He's a player that can play all five positions on the court.
Jonathan Cox now back in for the Panthers. Moses shakes free inside, slapped away. Two-on-one break. Hill goes to the hoop and puts it down. And the Panthers go back on top by one.
They've met the charge so far. You got to admire that. They're not folding the tent.
And this is with Jason Reese on the bench with three fouls. Ingram, right corner. They're looking still to post up inside to Moses. Earl. Just nice. Too big a body inside.
Nice drive by Michael Ingram. That's something you don't see out of Michael very often, the dribble drive.
It's also nice for the Hawkeyes to get some points from Earl.
Oh, almost loses it. That's a three from Hill. Yes!
3 points from Hill!
Great back. Ball game. Look at that rebound.
Long outlet pass to McCullough. He slides almost off the court. Can't catch up to it. He was open for a minute. The pass just too far.
Well, Bob and Bob, I'd have to say the same thing. I was just thinking, what a great fans game.
Hope you're enjoying it at home. We've got a timeout. 2-point lead for the Panthers. 50-48. How about this ball game? Back with more on ITN.
You find it in promises, and you find it in plans, in the midst of laughter, and in silences shared. When the deal is sealed, and when the dance is done, it's there. And for 80 million responsible Americans, it's simply a good part of the good life. It's beer. A message from Budweiser.
Take a look at this transition game. First, the block on one end, then Muhlenberg on the break. Ahead to Hill, he goes in for the bucket. Brad Hill, somebody, the Panthers just waiting to break out and have a big ball game, score 25, 30 points.
He said at half, look for a fourth player, somebody new to come in and have a good second half. Hawkeye shooting 63% in the second half. The Panthers have gotten 12 shots, but only made a third of them, 33% in this half.
You and I by two. There's the battle of the boards.
Moses went on the stepped on the end line as he went to the dribble. He can't believe the call, but it was a good one.
Cox splits that Iowa pressure. Cam Johnson, the freshman, now in along with Cox. Fight. Troy Muhlenberg and Hill. Jason Reese still sitting on the sideline with three fouls.
Muhlenberg
shakes free in the corner. Now back out on top. Cox not really one to look for the shot. The freshman Cam Johnson has not looked for the shot either today. Muhlenberg from downtown gets his own rebound. How many times has he done that today?
He does it his whole career.
He just follows the shot brilliantly. Great pass.
Ingram will pick up that foul. Ingram throws bodies everywhere. He thought it should have gone against Fife, but Michael Ingram gets the foul going for the rebound.
A lot of aggressive bodies in this game. Garner giving it up. Thompson making the athletic ability, trying to get the free throw. And then the foul underneath. You got two fouls taking place there.
Steve Fife wanted an intentional foul. He put his wrists across and said, two-shot foul. He thought it was intentional.
And
Michael Ingram is down. There you see the edge of that court drops off about 3 inches before it goes to the backing. He may or may not have hit that, but appears to have injured that right knee. John Street, the Iowa trainer, goes over along with Tom Davis. They've already got Matt Bullard on the bench waiting to come back from his knee injury. What a blow it would be for this one.
Apparently Matt Bullard might be ready for that Saturday game against Ohio State. He was out running through plays is probably the best thing to say, but he hasn't done any contact work at this point.
Ingram being helped off. He's had surgery, major surgery, on that left leg you see wrapped up so heavily. It appears to be the right knee that he's favoring. Matt Bullard said he thought he was ready to play tonight if needed. He'd go in. Let's put it that way.
I don't think there's any question. He said, Coach Davis, I get to be start tonight, don't I? Coach Davis said, you better talk to the doctor, son. And I think it really is going to come down to when he gets full range of motion back in that knee. You can feel good, but you've got to understand what movement a knee has to make on a basketball court.
Steve Fife at the line for two. The senior from Nashua, Iowa, transfer from Oral Roberts. He's got 10 now, hits double figures. That's a three-point lead for the Panthers.
Look at Jepson swing those elbows. One of these days, he's going to get called for it.
I think the crowd agreed with you here. The UNI people started to boo.
And it's the first time I think we've seen UNI in a zone.
Eldon Miller has said he likes to play zone when he wants to change the tempo of a basketball game. Ball still alive. Lookingville comes up with it. Put a new 45 on the shot clock.
Well, and credit Earl for getting that ball back because he tipped the ball off the board, reaching in.
The second time tonight, the exact same spot, just about Lookingville loses the basketball, this time at the other end of the court. Tom Davis can't believe it, right through his hands.
Jepson right in your face, that'll scare you, huh? You know who Jepson reminds me of? Mac, you may remember this player that played for you and I almost a decade ago, Ray Stork.
Yeah.
Very, very similar.
Johnson inbounds to Turner. 13:45 left, 51-48. The Panthers by three. Mullenberg inside the five over AC Earl, another block. Moses back the other way, tries to take it coast to coast, and Cam Johnson gets called for the foul, reaching in.
That's what Moses has got to do a little bit better. Court awareness. He had three white shirts ahead of him. Look, there isn't a black shirt near it. Trailing the play, three white shirts ahead of him. You got to just stop and wait for a trailer.
14 fouls against the Panthers, six against you and I. Moses inside the land of the Giants, puts it down.
A good great inside position. Yeah.
Good seal off by the Iowa Hawkeyes inside, allowing Moses just to go straight up. His teammates were around him.
1 point UNI lead, 51-50. Hill breaking the pressure, finds Turner to Fife. Jam time. And give the credit to Dale Turner. Great feed to the baseline.
That's right. He made AC Earl commit. Earl was thinking he was going to get another block. He didn't get it. Fife checking the clock right now, which says 12:52, and the Panthers up by three. Boy, the intensity on the Panther faces tells all the story in this one. Could be the biggest game in the history of the school if they can pick up a win.
We got to look at the zone. A couple things are happening. You and I players are getting some rest. And Iowa, I was just going to say, was having trouble shooting from the outside.
Wayne Lookingville gets it to go down.
Just and inside the ball, the three-point line.
Almost lost again. Turner fighting with Moses to get him across. And the blocking foul will go against Skinner. Troy Skinner picks up number two. And now the Panthers are in the 1-1 with 12:13 left.
And look who's coming back in. Here's Jason.
Jason Reese with three fouls. He's been sitting now for about 5 minutes.
And really wasn't a factor, frankly. Was having trouble against the big guys inside.
It has been the perimeter and transition game of the UNI Panthers that have given him this lead.
Turner, 2 of 2 from the line so far tonight with 7 points. Shooting 68% from the line. Had an ankle sprain 2 days ago in practice on Monday. Looked like he could miss some practice time, but it doesn't appear to have affected him.
It was a little scary for the Panthers at that time. Bob, you and I were there at practice. We rolled it over, and everybody stopped for just a quick second.
Thompson inside to Earl for the soft jumper off the glass. Webb tries to tie up Hill. He breaks three. 3-on-2 break. Hill. Woo!
Oh, my. What a big-time jam. Yes, sirree. Panthers by three. This place is rocking in the dome. Holy cow.
Hill brings them to their feet. AC Earl with a little soft jumper, and it's Webb with the putback. Reese comes down with the rebound. And it's the Hawkeyes that don't appear to be getting back on defense.
Hollenberg Reese's legs. Look at Earl get up.
Earl loses the basketball. The Panthers will have it underneath their own basket. 11-12 left here to play. 55-52. We've got a timeout on the floor. The Panthers leading by three. We'll take a break on ITN. We'll go now to our local stations for a special news story.
Panthers by three after this big time slam by Brad Hill, the JC transfer. Eldon Miller picking him up through his contacts with the JC players, and he'll do a little taunting there after the big time jam.
In fact, when you talk contact, that's exactly what it was. Dave Schultz, the coach at Lakeland Junior College, played for Eldon Miller and just said, Brad, you're going to go to UNI.
And he did.
And he's here.
He's happy after that slam. You bet he is.
He looks like that mysterious man that somebody was looking for some offense. Eldon Miller's picked up some points from Hill.
No.
Cox driving to the hoop. Over Jefferson. There's an unlikely hero.
And an unexpected shot.
I think Les was as surprised as anybody. 5'10 against 7 foot.
That's right. When we went into the pregame talk, Coach, you didn't tell me about that drive.
I'll tell you, Jonathan Cox got 6 rebounds against Georgetown. He said he kept jumping up, and the highest he ever got was to Mutombo's waistline.
Jepson throws up an air ball. Panthers can take their biggest lead of the half. They're up by 5. Reese pulls up.
They need him. They need him to score.
And Iowa needs Ray Thompson to put it in.
Charge.
Thompson picks up the foul. That's number 3.
Thompson bringing down on the break. Again, having to go by 3 UNI players. Cox trying to give good position in there. Goes down. UNI have position around the basket.
What a surprising hero on both ends of the court there. Young Mr. Cox comes in and makes 2 great plays.
Johnson. Across the 10-second line, tries to take it all the way, slapped away. Tried to throw it off one of the Iowa players' legs, and now a 3-on-2 break. And Garner throws it away.
Deflected, it looked like, by Cam Johnson on the trail.
Tried to go a no-look pass to Ingram, and he just actually waited maybe a fraction of a second too long.
AC Earl looks inside to Thompson, and Iowa does what they do so well. That score off the inbounds play.
And they get the turnover. Look at the turnover stats.
Again, you've got to say it's surprising. Iowa's turnovers, a lot of them become unforced, driving into double teams, triple teams, where UNI has their turnovers from the Iowa pressure.
Dale Turner is back into the ballgame for the Panthers. Also, Cedric McCullough.
Watch the Iowa players seal on the inbound.
Then a great steal. Great play by Turner, but he had his toes just on the line.
You know, Bob, if there's one surprising stat in the second half, it's the fact Iowa had committed 7 turnovers in the first 6.5 minutes of play, and UNI's at the 1-1.
Thompson misses. The ball slapped away. Ingram hits the floor hard. And Turner will walk it across, try to slow it down a little bit. He needs some help to get it across. 3-point Panther lead. We're under 10 minutes now. Mullenberg. And Earl goes over McCullough for the rebound.
That was a great rebound.
Thompson takes 3 baseline right into Fife. They'll call the foul against Steve Fife.
How long you got to be there, Fife?
Fife thought he'd been charged. But they're just not going to call an offensive foul every time on Thompson.
Well, looking, Bill did a good job of screening along the baseline, giving Thompson a lane to go to the basket. And the reaching foul occurred, as you see Hill check back in, and of course, Les Jepson.
And Earl stepping across to make the Twin Tower situation, and you and I had a little bit of trouble with this earlier in the ballgame.
Thompson's been the offense.
The whole
for
season.
Iowa, 19, make it 20. He's above his average, 19.6. And we have a timeout on the floor. 9:19 left to play. Panthers by two, 57-55. Back with more on the Iowa Television Network. Back to the UNI Dome, a record crowd on hand for UNI in Iowa, 23,000, and they've got their money's worth so far, 57-55, with just over 9 minutes left to play.
Iowa doing what they do best on the national level, 33-29, starting to take charge on the boards.
Thompson comes up short. 57-55, a two-point lead. Pressure again. Triple team. Hill tries to dribble out of it. Breaks free to McCullough. That's Dale Turner down into the corner to McCullough. Back to Turner. He had the shot. Didn't take it.
I think Iowa's defense played a little bit more intensity here right now.
Shot clock is down below 10. Somebody will have to take it. 4-3. Hill, that's not his shot. Forced to take it up. And McCullough picks up a foul, battling with Jepson on the backboard.
You could hear the entire UNI Dome yelling and screaming, shoot, get a shot off. And then they had to force one.
That's Jepson's 11th rebound. That's putting him up there where he's been, the Big Ten leader already this season, throwing him into the national lineup.
Iowa has a couple of leaders in the Big Ten scoring stats, steals, James Moses.
James Moses leads in steals, and you've got Wade Lookingbill leading in free throw shooting.
Just wanted to remind you that we're going to name the Budweiser most valuable player late in this ball game, so we'll be talking about that.
We don't have to tell anybody to stay tuned, though, I don't think.
We're going to have to figure out who.
A lot of candidates.
The lob inside. A.C. Earl working. Gets it to go. Pfeiffer pick up the foul. And we're tied at 57.
Well, you're getting some maturity happening right there with A.C. Earl. He's showing me something.
And that is a mature move that you're looking at. A little ball fake. One hand in the other. Goes up. I'll tell you, A.C. Earl got a little good luck habit of his own. His shoestrings, one's black, one's white.
Been doing that for a while, I guess, hasn't he?
Yeah, since junior high.
They're going to try it again.
Somebody crossed the line. So Earl will get a second shot. A.C. Earl, 70% from the line. Misses his second chance. Tie ball game, 57. 8 minutes left to play. Turner to Reese, all alone inside. Jason Reese gets on the board. First 2 points of the second half. 5 Les Jepson, Wade Lookingbill, the five in for the Hawkeyes. Moses on top. He'll pump it up. And knotted again. 59 all. Turner with the 3-on-1 break. To Hill. Up over A.C. Earl. And Earl will pick up the foul.
A.C. Earl really trying to guard that basket. Taking a 3-on-1 challenge. But Hill has really come on in this second half, played himself a ball game.
7 points, all of them in the second half, Mac, and he is not afraid to take the ball to the hoop.
It's one thing the coaching staff had talked about, that Hill really needed to play with more confidence in a big game, come out, challenge people. They know he has the talent to do it.
Probably the best leaper on this UNI ball club. He's shown it tonight in a couple of plays. Hits the free throw.
Better than Fife?
I would say so. I'd like to see the two of them in a slam dunk contest. That would be worth the price of admission. They had a midnight madness here before the season to kick it off, and part of that was a slam dunk contest. It was the first chance a lot of the folks got to see Brad Hill, and there were some oohs and some ahs that night. He was putting on a show.
Muhlenberg coming back in, and he has been a tremendous factor in tonight's ball game. I think his shooting early on gave UNI the confidence it needed to break out against this Iowa team.
Again, a zone by UNI. They're going to force Iowa to beat him from the outside. Skinner's going to have to light it up with a three.
Iowa has been very poor this year from the three-point line, only shooting as a team.
I think that's a real big concern as they go into the Big Ten.
27%.
No good there.
Just 2 of 10, I believe, against Monmouth the other night when they struggled so much on offense. Not the place you want to pass the basketball. Into the corner where McCullough got blocked by 2 or 3 players. Ingram comes up with the block.
Boy, Reese having a real frustrating night. He was cleanly blocked right there. And everybody's taking turns on him. A.C. Earl, Ingram, and Jepson.
I think that Colgate smile there was a bit of sarcasm on his part to the official.
Yeah, it was.
John Cox goes out. Dale Turner comes back in. Two-point Panther lead, 61-59. 6:36 left to play. Muhlenberg looks for the shot, gets it. Jepson all alone on the offside for the rebound.
He's cooled off considerably after a red-hot early part of the ball game.
Nice James Moses somehow inside the crowd.
He's just a great athlete. He's going to score like that all year long.
Muhlenberg wide open. And Muhlenberg has gone ice cold from the field. Thompson looks to the hoop to score. And does.
Muhlenberg missing a couple of wide open shots. And now all of a sudden Iowa's on top with under 6 left. And he passed up a shot that time. I think he's lost his legs. He just looks like he's tired.
Dale Turner looks over to the UNI bench. Eldon Miller says he wants to take a timeout. 61-63, make it 63-61. Iowa on top, 5:50 left. Back with more on ITN, just a minute. Range on the year, UNI a little better at 43%. 1 out of 6 for the Hawkeyes, 4 of 13 for UNI. Most of those belong to Troy Muhlenberg.
Yeah, you got your three-point shooter. You put him on the bench there. That's how frustrating it's been. Skinner sits down.
Well, UNI just made one of their last 5. Iowa continues to substitute.
Hill down low in the corner. Back to Muhlenberg. He has suddenly gone cold. Back to Turner on top. Turner from 3. Off the mark. UNI is struggling to find somebody to give them some offense.
Well, remember last year when they two teams played, it was a close game until very late. Then Iowa pulled away as UNI just got tired down the stretch.
Hawkeyes feel maybe the Panthers have gotten a little tired. Panthers have had to go back to man-to-man defense. I will try and set up maybe a particular play to score.
Almost a steal there.
Hill on Thompson. Jason Reese coming way out on A.C. Earl. That's Brian Garner. The shot clock is under 10. Garner with the pick from Ingram. Goes baseline. Garner inside a crowd. And he is fouled. And that may be against Reese.
And if it is, that's number 4. And he's got that disgusted look on his face.
It is on Reese.
This is a high post pick where Garner is able to go right. Then he has to reverse himself to come back across the pick along the block.
Cheap foul.
Well, it's a reach, though. That's, that's a tired reach.
It's a reaction, too.
Yeah. The shot clock was down to 3. Garner was going to put up a shot that, maybe would have gone, maybe not. And all of a sudden, you got Reese reaching like that in a tired situation. Five sitting down.
Jason Reese will stay in with that 4th foul. Steve Fife goes out. And it is a 3-point lead, 64-61. 4:35 left. McCullough across the 10 to Muhlenberg. He's been cold.
They needed that. 2-point shot, though.
Pulls him within a point at 64-63. Garner again penetrating inside.
Oh, what a move.
you give Brian Gardner some space, keep the big men out of there, he can take you to the hole in one step.
66-63. Quickly inside, the race has it knocked away. Back to Muhlenberg, a three. Yes!
Muhlenberg bombs away. Look at this. A tie ball game with 3:56 left. Did you expect this?
Not at 66. The Panthers are not giving up, not giving in.
Hey, thanks for paying for my ticket from Hawaii, guys.
I'll tell you, the traffic jam will be bigger than people thought. Nobody's going home early.
And now you hear the chant from the crowd, UNI.
Oh, my, what a pass, and chant to AC.
That quiets them very quickly. UNI back in the break the other way. Reese inside. Hits his own rebound. Blocked. And the foul may go against AC Earl. Brian Garner has got his hand up. He wants out. He needs a breather. You'll see Skinner back in quickly.
But Reese, you know he knew that those big-time blockers were there in his face. He would never miss that layup if he hadn't had so many of his shots rejected early. Look at this pass inside. It's a tremendous pass. Looks like a shot. Everybody relaxes, and then Earl has the two.
Jason Reese will go to the line. He's got 8 points tonight that helped way under his average. 2 of 2 from the line. And that's usually another indication of when you're tired, when the free throws don't go down like they normally do.
And Reese is a great free throw shooter, so you know he's really tired.
For the Panthers, 68 for the Hawks, 3:22 left to play. The crowd is on their feet around the edges of the dome. Jepson shakes free inside.
They just backdoored Reese, who was fronting. 3-point lead again. Could have been a foul there, wasn't called. Muhlenberg wants the ball.
And Jepson pulls down the rebound on the offside. The Hawkeyes by three, now under 3 minutes left.
And that is 13 rebounds for Les Jepson. That's why the pros want to look at him.
And now the Hawkeyes pull it out a little higher. They're going to the weave.
And they're going to the roll offense. This is where they will ball handle out front and make a man foul them. If not, you've got a one-on-one move to the basket.
Something you might do in a situation where you feel the other team is dragging, is a little tired. Catch that one player who doesn't have any help back behind him.
Davis wants a timeout.
We've got a timeout on the floor. 2:30 left to play. Hawkeyes by three, 70-67.
It is everything, absolutely everything. Written about it, said about it. I mean, Bob, it's a great one.
It really is. You know, it's a game that lived up to the event. And so much of the time, the event is just way outweighs the game. It's been a tremendous night for the state of Iowa. It's been a tremendous night for the UNI program. And then it's just been great for basketball fans everywhere watching this ballgame.
Yet this is not a situation as in years past where you and I would say, gee, we were close, we played a good game, yeah, we lost, we hung with Iowa. They still believe they can win this game.
In fact, really looking at it, I think Iowa expected to win coming into the game. You and I was certain they would win. And there's something to be said for the attitudes, the mental attitude of preparedness for this game. Iowa, last five shots, they made all of them, 7 of their last 8. That's why they got the 3-point lead.
Well, then Muhlenberg coming back in. He looked like he was tired. He missed several shots in a row. He finally found his rhythm. He hit a 2-pointer, then he hit a 3-pointer, and they need him. They also need something from Jason Reese, who's really been taken out of his ball game. And you really have to credit the big men, Jepson and Earl, for doing that from Iowa. And I think the Iowa fans got to be really happy with the play of AC Earl. And they got to love this kid.
Earl with the inbounds pass to Skinner. Skinner, Earl, Jepson, the Twin Towers, along with Moses and Thompson for the Hawkeyes. And it's Moses shaking free inside. Reese playing in foul trouble, lets him take it up and put it down.
That was a big move, though.
It was one that you would say, don't throw it back out. And then you go, great shot, James.
As long as it goes down. And the Iowa lead is 5 as we approach the 2-minute mark. Reese comes up short. They'll give it to the Panthers underneath.
And you're right about tired legs out there. Looks like Jason Reese almost went up in 2 movements.
Well, he was turning, wondering where the block was, too.
That's still UNI's ball if they save it.
Not a backcourt.
They only got 10 to get it across the timeline, though. And usually you get pressure.
Turner finds McCullough down low. Hill wants the basketball from three. Yes! Brad Hill pulls the Panthers within two at 72-70.
Only 1:35 left. Here's that weave. The crowd is buzzing right now. You can feel the electricity.
Thompson trying to go one-on-one.
Five seconds.
Call.
What you got in basketball, you can dribble the ball for 4 seconds, hold it for 4 seconds, and there's no problem. But once you start doing one or the other and you get to a five-second call, it's a turnover.
Now every possession becomes so critical. 1:25 left to play. Two-point lead for the Hawks. UNI's basketball. Full court pressure now by the Hawkeyes.
One of the shot blockers just stepped out. Earl almost an over and back there.
Hill, he wants the ball. Yes!
Yes! Oh!
Does he feel it?
The Panthers on top!
74-72.
No, it's 73-72.
That was a three-pointer.
Skinner missing.
And he's got McCullough wide open. Three-on-one break. Skinner to Turner.
Good! Do you believe it?
Three-point lead under a minute. And Iowa wants a timeout. The crowd is going crazy. They're on their feet, 23,000 strong.
The Panthers believe they can win this game. What a comeback.
Who said anything about tired legs? Let's look at that last bucket again.
And it has been Brad Hill in the second half. A man that was not heard from in the first 20 minutes. Scoring, stealing, dribbling and passing. And Iowa again on the negative side of the turnovers. They've got 21.
It's still Brad Hill. 15 points all in the second half for the Panthers.
Well, he wanted the ball too. He had that look on his face. Give me the ball. I want it. I know that the shot is going to be there. He puts up the threes. He made that great slam dunk early. What a tremendous job. And he's coming alive, coming into his own.
Well, now it's going to be a coach's choice. You're really looking at 43 seconds on the shot clock, 51 on the game clock. Does Iowa want to go for three and tie the game up and give you and I a chance to win it? Or will Iowa go for two, still remain one behind, and then have to figure a way to get the ball back from you and I? I look for him to go for two, passively inside, try and even get a foul to get that third point, get an easier opportunity inside, and then rely on the press to steal.
Now the Panthers pick up all the way. Jepson way out on top. Skinner. And remember, Iowa is a very poor three-point shooting team. It could haunt them right now. Thompson, maybe their best three-point shooter. He tries to drive. Hill goes down. And it's Reese ahead to McCullough. Two-on-one break. McCullough to the hoop. He traveled. No basket.
What a series of calls there. One, you don't get the offensive charge at the other end. Probably should have gotten it. Then you get a travel the other way. Goodness sakes.
The shot clock is off. 36 seconds left. 75-72 our score. Iowa from three-point range, 1 of 6. On the game, just 16%. Brad Hill with a tremendous second half. 15 points all in the second half. Iowa needs a three to tie.
And Skinner is out. Look for Moses or Thompson.
Garner. Off the mark. The ball slapped away. Garner in a foot race with Hill for the basketball. The shot clock is off. Down to 20 seconds. Moses, he can hit it. No good. They have to foul. Tipped away.
Look at this. UNI is going to win it.
Oh.
UNI is going to win it. This place is going to go wild. With 5 seconds left, they're jumping all over the place. What a night for UNI.
Fans on their feet screaming.
Just look at it. Well, you and I felt they needed to beat and big-time quality team in order to make themselves a real contender for the NC2A playoffs. And, of course, the playoff tournament is here in the Dome, automatic qualifier by winning the tournament.
Discussion right now as to how many seconds are left on the clock.
Bob Justice, the PA announcer, over by the official scores. The official is over at the table. As of right now, there is 4 seconds on the shot clock.
This place is about ready to explode. I can feel the bodies behind me right now. You get the feeling they're going to come up
closer
over the top of us if UNI wins this ball game.
And we may
Miller's
see,
talking about a timeout right now.
We may see mass hysteria here at the Dome. These people could come streaming down onto the floor.
Of course, Tom Davis, I think at halftime was concerned a couple seconds ran off the clock.
The official is over here now speaking to us on the sidelines. He wants to see a replay to see how much time is left on the clock. I don't believe that we have. We do not have a clock replay. We can't help you.
I think it was 5 seconds. I said five when the ball went out of bounds, but we do not have a clock replay. The clock's right now at 4.
I believe it was 5.
It's an interesting situation where we all of a sudden we become part of the officiating crew. You saw that happen one time with Brent Musburger, remember, in that NCAA game, where they had come over and check on the clock.
We did not have the second superimposed in the right-hand corner of the screen, but I believe there was 5 seconds, and they let it go down to 4 as the clock went off. Will 1 second make a difference at 77-72? I doubt it.
Not with a 5-point game. But, you know, big story here, UNI coming back when they were tired. Brad Hill playing tremendously. Iowa making crucial turnovers down the stretch.
You got to look at it right now. I think we have to introduce our Budweiser most valuable player in tonight's game as Brad Hill.
No surprise there, especially with the way he played down the stretch. We were talking about who would be the most valuable player, who would come to the forefront. He's the player that did it.
Well, we'd certainly like to congratulate Brad Hill for his outstanding, I mean outstanding, second half performance. And it's what the coaching staff had been looking for out of him to elevate his game and gain the confidence.
Tom Davis, Eldon Miller are both at the official scoring table right now. Tom Davis is adamant there is more time on the clock, and he is screaming at Eldon and the officials. And now we are going to see 2 extra seconds put back on the clock. The PA announcer, Bob Justice, has said we will put 2 more seconds back. There will be 6 seconds on the clock. Eldon Miller is calling his players over to the sideline, and Tom Davis picked up an extra second.
Well, I hate to go with history again, but one time several years ago, I saw UNI lose a ball game in this situation, where a basket was scored, they inbounded it, the team stole the ball underneath and scored again. I don't remember the exact situation, but I remember the player, and I hate to do this to you, Jay, but it was Jay Block that threw the inbound pass when he was just a freshman. He went on to be a great player here at UNI, and they lost that ball game. So it can happen, although it's very, very unlikely.
Well, it was just 3 years ago they had the great finish that UNI won against Cleveland State. Mike Bailey threw the length of the court pass with 1 second left to go. Kirk Francis put it in. So, I don't know, this game has to rival that. But I'll tell you, a lot more people are seeing this one.
Who could have written a better ending to this game? 6 seconds left, Skinner into Moses. He throws it up way off balance. The ball bounces out of bounds. 2 seconds, 1 second on the clock. You and I will still have to inbound. But the crowd is starting to go crazy. They know it is over. Thompson at the buzzer. It will count. The final score, UNI 77, Iowa 74. For the first time since 1914, the Panthers have beaten the Hawkeyes.
And I'll tell you, it's a heck of a lot bigger than it was before World War I. This is an incredible moment. Look at the fans. They are streaming onto the court. I think that the controversy there probably kept a few of them off, as well as some of the security folks, but what a win for their program.
Well, I think you've got to say, kids at home, your parents may be a little late, in getting there.
The crowd begins to celebrate. The players still hugging each other on the floor. 77-74, UNI has done it. We'll take a break and be back in just a moment. What a ball.